I'm going to make some general remarks about what I think complexity economics is, and then I'm going to go on and present some applications for my own work, and then the applications will be developed more in the second session today. I think everybody's probably familiar with the way standard economic theory works. You have agents with utility functions or something like it. Each agent has a model of the world, and each agent selfishly maximizes their own utility. You use this framework to derive first order conditions, and that's essentially the script that every theoretical economics paper, almost everyone follows. Now, why is this not? Okay, excuse me. I'm having a problem getting my slides to advance. Okay, just a second. Damn it, just a minute. Okay, I need to do this differently. I'm going to set the view, just enter full screen. Okay, now, wait, need to go back. Damn it. Excuse me. I'm having a hard time getting this to advance properly. All right, good. Okay. So, all right. I'm calling the I think of complexity economics as a revolution. That is, it's if you compare it with a standard method, it uses a very different, radically different methodology. First of all, rather than writing down utility functions and deriving first order conditions, we model behaviors directly. There is good evidence from the psychological literature that this is a sensible thing to do. It's what real people tend to do. It's not that we don't have goals, but we use heuristics and learning algorithms. And when we have goals, they're fairly explicit goals. They're not generic goals like log utility. I think a key aspect is using feasible information. That is, agents act with information that agents could plausibly have. And then we're in a world of nonlinearity, so we model dynamics through simulation. The simulations might or might not converge to equilibrium. In fact, as we've shown in a paper in the context where we've exhaustively studied normal form game theory, that's very unlikely if the game is competitive and complicated and the players are using bounded rationality-based algorithms. Karshamis has also shown that it becomes unlikely when the setup is too unstable. And there's a general philosophy of trying to model things from the bottom up as far as that makes sense. Now, I think there's several clear advantages of this approach. It's got what I call verisimilitude. That is, it's as is rather than as if. It easily incorporates information from behavioral economics. Endogenous dynamics often emerges. It doesn't always emerge, but sometimes it does. And this approach copes with uncertainty as opposed to risk. That is, it's operatable in a world where we don't necessarily know the probabilities of all events and or even know the set of possible outcomes. And most importantly, perhaps, it's scalable. That is, you can take a real world situation that might be pretty complicated, where the first order conditions are likely impossible to solve if you really put all the elements that were essential into the problem. And it gives you a set of heuristics for just plunging forward and modeling the real world. There are disadvantages. There's less formal structure. Different set of skills are required. Calibration can be challenging. These kind of models crave microdata. You really want data about what's happening at a finer scale than aggregate data. And there's a huge task to properly develop what's going on. Maybe to contrast the two approaches in standard economic theory, as Jimmy Savage called, he said it suited for what he called small world problems, where possible outcomes and their probabilities are known, an example being designing an auction, versus complexity economics, be overkill for those kind of problems, but it becomes useful when the outcomes are uncertain or when you have complicated structure. An example might be climate change. And now I'm going to go through and just illustrate first with some more conceptual examples, a few of these points. I'm going to begin by talking about cycles and endogenous dynamics, and then just present a few other more applied applications. So one of the things you often see when you have bounded rationality is that you begin to get cycles. A metaphor that I like to use for this is someone balancing a pole with their hand. If you take a pole in your hand, think of, say, a mop handle, as long as the pole's longer than about a meter, you can maintain it more or less vertical. More or less, but not exactly vertical. So then the question is, why is that pole oscillating? Think of the pole as the economy. Why is it oscillating? Well, if you were a standard rational expectations DSGE modeler, you would write down a model that assumes that the pole balancer is a perfect pole balancer, possibly constrained by some frictions of some sort or another, and that there are shocks hitting the pole from the room that are making it move around, and then the pole balancer is always responding to those shocks to bring the pole perfectly back to vertical. And you say, well, that's a good approximation, even then we know real pole balancers aren't that way. But that's not the essence of what causes the pole to oscillate. In reality, poles oscillate even in a room that's perfectly still, because real pole balancers are not perfect, and they overshoot and undershoot, and they do so in a way that, interacting with a pole, they tend to fall into oscillations that are at the resonant frequencies of the pole. And it's a completely different way of looking at it, and it gives rise to endogenous oscillations. So now I'm going to give a couple of examples where that happens. One is a model that we made. We started with a standard economics model, the RCK model, for savings rate. So the standard model, you assume there's a rational representative household, single one, that chooses a savings rate to maximize discounted consumption. And that household invests their savings in some representative firm that makes the right, and the household decides the right compromise between consumption and investment. And you can derive a golden rule. Well, in our version, we have heterogeneous households that have a social network, and at intermittent intervals, each copies the savings rate of its neighbor that happens to have the highest consumption at that point in time, and then holds on to that savings rate for a while until the household wakes up again and redoes the copying operation. So when you do this, you instantly get oscillations in GDP. You get oscillations in the savings rate. In fact, in that particular model, you see a divergence between the population tends to self-organize into rich and poor, the rich having high savings rates, the poor having low savings rates. And interestingly, you can get remarkably close to the golden mean, even though, let's just go back a slide, this is a really stupid algorithm. All the agents do is copy each other. Nobody's doing any thinking in it. And yet you can get remarkably close to the golden mean, but you oscillate around it. So that's just a conceptual idea. We're not saying that's a great model for business cycles. Here's another model of financial crisis that builds on equilibrium work that the discussant John Giannakopoulos did, but takes it in a different direction. We set out to model the great financial crisis in a very schematic way. And so in the plot that I'm showing you here, which is real data, we see the dash blue line, which is the S&P stock index over time. We see the rust colored curve, which is the VIX, that it's a volatility index for the stock market. And we see the solid black line, which is the leverage of broker dealers. And so what you see is there's this long period where the stock market makes a nice smooth run up, where volatility gets very low, where leverage gradually creeps up until it spikes. And then following the spike, there's a big spike in volatility, and things go into a different mode for a while. So we set out to make a simple model that would do that. Actually, we started with a complicated model, and we had, you know, different banks playing the stock market, and lots of complicated things happen. And we said, well, okay, now let's give them better risk management. So we gave them better risk management, that is the Basel protocol, and the whole economy started to oscillate. And we said, wait a minute, what's going on? And so we began stripping it down until we created the simplest thing we possibly could, that captured what was going on. So that led to the two papers above, both led by Christoph Eymans. In this model, we have two agents, a bank and a fundamentalist, one risky asset plus cash. We make four assumptions. Banks use an exponential moving average of historical volatility to estimate their expected volatility. They use Basel II risk management, that's value at risk, to set their leverage target. We assume supply equals demand. And we assume fundamentalists buy undervalued assets and vice versa. Very simple. What do we get? Well, if the banking sector is small enough or the amount of leverage they're using is low enough, then we get the market just, and this is without any noise, the general model has noise in it, but we get the economy settling into a steady state. But if we turn up the leverage or we turn up the size of the banking sector, this destabilizes and you see spontaneous oscillations. And I just want to mention that the x-axis here is not arbitrary units, those are years. And this model, if you put in an exponential moving average of 2 years, it gives you a kind of great moderation-like run-up of 10 or 15 years, and then followed by a crash. And that repeats itself, not periodically, but chaotically in an endogenous motion. Now, going on to a more practical application, I'm going to say a bit about a couple of models we made, or a model we made to analyze the economic impact of COVID. We began by predicting the shocks a priori. We constructed a remote labor index. We made a list of essential industries. We used a study on a hypothetical study of what would be the reduction in demand if we had a flu pandemic from 2006. And then we used that to make fine-grained predictions for the supply and demand shocks for 450 occupations and 55 industries. So just to give you a feeling, this is what things look like at the occupation level. We could predict the size of the demand shock on the x-axis or the supply shock on the y-axis for all of these 450 different occupations from just characteristics of the occupations compiled by the Bureau of Labor Statistics. And then we made a dynamic disequilibrium input-output model that we used to make conditional forecasts of the UK economy. We had 55 industries. We had assumed there was an inventory associated with each industry that we could calibrate against government statistics. We ran the model on a daily timescale, and we created a bespoke modified Leontief production functions that differed for each industry based on a survey of industry analysts, which, by the way, we managed to do in a few weeks. And we tested several possible lockdown policies, including one like the one that the UK went into or transitioned into after initial very hard lockdown. We predicted, this is a real-time prediction, we predicted 21.5% reduction in second quarter GDP in 2020. In reality, what happened was a 22.1% reduction. This model was micro-calibrated without any regressions against target data. And this shows our predictions at the sector level. You can see they're not as accurate as the aggregate level. We did have some luck of things averaging out, but we still had a pretty high correlation industry by industry between what happened and what we predicted would happen. Flying along to try and stay on time, we built a model for the financial stability of the European banking system that looks at detailed balance sheets of banks and simulates what banks will do when they come under stress. We have a model of occupational mobility that looks at the factors that cause workers to change occupations and tracks the diffusion through the occupation space through time, based on a simplified EARN model for hiring and firing workers. So just to wrap up, I just to make a few concluding remarks. Complexity economics models have very different data needs. That is, we really crave, as I said, micro data for calibration. Unfortunately, that's not the philosophy that data is currently collected and distributed by government statistical agencies. This is something we really hope will start to change. I want to stress that all of the models I've mentioned, and I could give you a long list of others, are models that don't have utility functions, they don't have rational agents, they're no perfect maximizers. And you know, in general, we're not limited by how much realism we can put into them. I'm calling the approach that we're taking, where we're trying to build models from the micro level up to the global scale, global microeconomics. The idea is to let macro emerge from micro, taking advantage of heterogeneity rather than assuming it away, taking advantage of the fact that ultimately there is a lot more data at the micro scale, even if it's difficult to find. That actually allows one to get better statistical significance in models if you're appropriately parsimonious with other things. It lets endogenous dynamics merge, and it can predict more things because you have both a micro model and a macro model in one package. I want to emphasize that complexity economics is young. We're talking about something that's been going on for 30 or 40 years. Maybe you can say it reaches back to Herb Simon, or maybe you can even say Leontief already started things in motion, or maybe even Adam Smith, but still, it's not a well-developed field like dynamical DSGE models are. There's a lot of work we need to do, like building standard software libraries and coming up with more systematic methods. And my final slide, there's certainly been some resistance to this from the mainstream, though as I've tried to stress, I think the two things are dealing with different problems and are just better at doing different things. But it's not surprising there's a lot of resistance because what I'm talking about really requires abandoning foundational assumptions that have been used for 150 years. We should be cautious about abandoning such assumptions. We're talking about activity with very different skills and a very different toolkit and a whole different attitude toward the way science is done. If you'd like to find out more about my view on this, I have a popular book whose introduction can be found on my website at that link. Or you can look on the website of the Complexity Group at the Institute for New Economic Thinking at the Oxford Martin School. Thank you very much.